again. And I always encourage people, whoever has some kind of, you know, testimony or a praise or even a prayer request, if you want it to be known, you know, just let me know. And you'll be able to have the opportunity to come and share before the congregation. So our brother Andrew actually has something on his heart and he wanted to share. So I'm going to give this time to him, just so he can share what's on his heart. So after that, then we'll go ahead and our message. So.
Hello, everybody. Well, introductions. You know, as most of you know, some of you don't know, my name is Andrew. I'm a sinner, and I'm broken. But like we all are, I'm a child of God.
Hi, Andrew.
I know it sounds more like an AA meeting, right? But truly, though, that, you know, when we come here, we come to really just set our hearts before God and really put everything that we have on Him, right? Even our burdens, our sins, whatever we have from the week that stays there, we move on to our future and really see what God has in plan for us. So, with that said, let me go ahead and just open us up in prayer real quick. Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, God, I thank you for the wonderful God that you are. Always being here for us and allowing us to enjoy this beautiful Sunday afternoon with each other. Father, Lord, I pray whatever is on my heart that it may come from you, Father. That, you know, I may be nervous up here, not know what to say, but Lord, that you will fill me with these words of, you know, words of wisdom, Lord, words of strength, Lord, and truly allow just to speak through me, Lord, to even those who need to hear this message. And Father, Lord, I thank you just for being amazing God again, always being there for us, even through the good times and through the bad times, and always allowing us to just know that you love us. Thank you once again for my brothers and sisters here today. And I just pray this all in your wonderful name. Alright, so the reason why I wanted to come here and share today was my week was a rough week. Right? Like some of you know, no one's perfect, right? Life is never going to be easy. One thing I wanted to, you know, mention was, we always say God will give us something that we can handle, right? God would never give us more than we can't handle, right? But the truth is, I learned just even just yesterday that God will give us more than we can handle. Because then at certain points, God is going to show you that, hey, you can't do this on your own. You can't. And you need my help. And that's why I'm going to put that much on you so that you have nothing else but me. And that's what God has really shown me today, and I want to share with you. I want to go ahead and start with just in the scripture real quick. I want to go ahead and start with this one verse about Paul. Okay, so the sermon I've read was about Paul, about what he went through as a Christian, as with his brothers down, right? And it starts off with Paul saying this in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8. You guys want to open up to that real quick? Can I get an amen if you're there?
Amen.
Hey, it's all good. You got time, right? 2 Corinthians chapter 1, starting with verse 8. Everyone good? Alright. So it starts off in verse 8. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about the hardship we suffered in the province of Asia. We were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure, so that we despaired even of life. Indeed, in our hearts we felt the sentence of death, but this happened that we might not rely on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. He has delivered us from such a deadly peril, and He will deliver us. On Him we have set our hope that we will continue to deliver us. Man, when I read this, I was just like, wow. You know, this week has really been a portrait of God versus world for me. It was to choose one or the other. You can't live both. You can't. You can't say, I want the world, but then I want God. You can't say, I want God, but I want the world. And that's what God really showed me through my struggle. I'm going to tell you honestly, as a brother, you know, because you guys are my brothers and sisters, this week has been so burdensome that even at one point in time, I felt like giving up. I felt like giving up. And it's, you know, sometimes I say it's okay to feel like you want to give up. Don't do it though. Keep fighting, because in the end, it'll feel that much better. Starting from, you know, the first day of Monday, you know, I was already burdened from what happened during the week. And I wanted to go ahead and just say, you know what, I'm done with all this. I'm done with praying to God. I'm done with doing my QTs every day or praying. It's so hard. It's so hard. Why are you doing this to me, God? Why are you doing this? Those were my questions. Those are my questions. Why are you taking everything away from me? Why are you burdening me with such pain and grief? And why can't I understand your love? And there was two things that I learned throughout this week. That God, you know, from my past, I have a lot of things I've done wrong, right? A lot of things that I might regret, a lot of things that I have to grow off of. But God is a very disciplining God. And he even says in the Bible, let me see if I can pull it out real quick. It's going to be in right here. It says here. It's going to be in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 5. If you guys can open up to that real quick. Give me an amen once you guys find it. This is just one of the first things that I've learned. Part of what I need to do as growing. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 5, starting at verse 5. Can I get an amen if you're there? Mm-hmm. Alright. Well, it starts off saying, "And you have forgotten that word of encouragement that addresses you as sons. My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when he rebukes you. Because the Lord disciplines those he loves, and he punishes everyone he accepts as sons. Endure hardship as discipline. God is treating you as a son, for what son is not disciplined by his father?" And when I really looked at that, it showed me. You know, I asked God, I said, "God, why are you burdening me with all this? Why do I feel like I'm being punished?" And maybe I was. Maybe I was being punished for the things I've done to grow. Because, you know, when we think about a good father, not only does a good father love, but a good father also disciplines so that we can grow. To say, "Don't do that. That's wrong. And I'm going to do something to show you that it's wrong so you can understand that." And sometimes it hurts. And sometimes it's, you know, like I called Petey and Sister Inna this week. I said, it sucks. It sucks. It really does. It feels like you don't have anything. But God is trying to really show you. So maybe God's trying to show you something. Something that you can't even seem to imagine. That's what God did for me. I realized what I was doing to myself, I was putting on myself, and God was showing me that I was being selfish. That I wasn't relying on Him. And He did everything in His power to say, "Look, you know what? I'm going to show you that I love you. Look, like, come see me. Oh, but you want to go here? Hey, stop. I'm your father. Come and look at me. I love you. And I won't leave you. But you have to listen to me." Just like any good father would, right? And that has really been a struggle in my life to accept, was that God was a disciplining God. You know, I always thought, you know, I could always pray to God about all the things I've done and it would be easy. That He'll take it off of me. But it's not true. But then I put it in a different light. I said that was one of the steps that I had to learn. The second step was, if you guys would flip to James chapter 1, verse 2. James chapter 1 verse 2. Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds. Because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lack wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. And that goes straight to the verse of 2 Corinthians, verse 8. You know, we feel like the whole world is against us. We feel like, you know, there's so much pressure that you can't handle. The only person that you can truly rely on is God. All right, so explaining my week, I told you I felt like giving up multiple times. I felt like there was so much pressure on my heart that I couldn't seem to be able to get rid of. So I tried working out. I tried going out. I tried driving around. I tried running in the streets, doing anything that could possibly make myself feel better. But I missed one thing. I missed that I was just had to get on my knees and just pray to God and just fully rely on Him. And this isn't, I'm not sharing this because I'm telling you it's going to get easier. I'm not sharing this because I'm going to tell you that life is so good at the end of the road. Because there is no end until we finally persevere and get into heaven. That's what I truly believe. But it's a fight. It's a fight that sometimes it's a fight just with yourself to understand that you just need to let go of your feelings, your emotions, how you feel about everything. And just trust in God that He will truly persevere for you. That He will give you victory. My whole life, I always wondered why. You know, the question was popping in my head, why when I came to praise band or Bible study teacher, why did I struggle so much? Why did I struggle in a spot of being a leader? Feeling like this, feeding all props to you. And, you know, thank God for always just feeding and blessing me. But every time I did that, I felt like there was a huge burden on my shoulders. And I felt it was my job as a Christian, my job. Me to do whatever I could to just fight it without relying on God. I said God was with me. I said God loves me. I said God is going to be my father. So you know what? I'm going to be able to do this. I'm going to do this for my father. But never did I say, God, it's so hard. Never did I tell God, I said, God, I feel ashamed. I feel wretched. I feel broken. God, help me. I decided to take it in my own strength. Saying, oh, look, I quit the things that I did. I was able to move on, but I'm still struggling. And I tell you as a brother, it's, you know, I still don't know all the answers. None of us do. But it's an amazing feeling when you truly get on your knees and you really set your heart upon God and say, God, I need your help and your help only. Not anyone else in this room can help me. Not anything in this world can help me, nor any cigarette or drug or alcohol can help me. And, you know, I have a testimony I want to share that many of you don't even know. There was a time in my past where I relied on drugs, alcohol, cigarettes, pornography, even cussing, friends, everything the world had to offer, I had it. Everything the world had to offer, I had it. But I remember I laid in bed one time when I was down in Virginia Tech. I was laying in my room and I said, I have everything that I want. Why do I still have no joy in my heart? At that point, right before I went to Virginia Tech, I left God. I told, you know, for me it's one or the other. I can't do both. I can't be a part of the world and be part of God. I can't do it. I feel too guilty. I can't be a part of the world but then try to love God. I don't see it. But at that moment when I really sat there and I felt so empty, I knew what I was missing. That was joy in my heart. I had a choice to make. My comfort or joy? My worldly comfort or salvation through heaven. And I know that's a choice that a lot of us make each and every day. It is the hardest decision to make. So when I remember coming back from Virginia Tech, I decided to quit everything again and then follow God. And then I realized when I follow God, I have joy in my heart, but then it's hard. Hard mentally, physically, emotionally. But I urge you, brothers and sisters, to keep fighting. Because even when you're past beyond that point and you feel like you can't help yourself, there is one person that can. That's God. Yeah, I really, throughout this week and really struggling, I really had to test myself, right? But it says, you guys could open up 1 Peter chapter 5. You know, it even says right here. I'm going to say one thing. God never said it was going to be easy. Amen. God never said it was going to be easy. Amen. I always get awkward when I'm up here. I'm not going to lie. I get nervous. I'm nervous. Like, even right now, I didn't know I could say all this. But with God, God is awesome, right? God is good.
1
Peter chapter 5, verse 8. Can I get an amen if you're there? It said, be self-controlled and alert. Your enemies, the devil, prowls like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. To devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of suffering. Your brothers are going through the same kind of suffering. Your brothers and sisters are out there. And the glory of all grace, who calls you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. We gotta stay patient, right? We just gotta continue to fight. It even says here that Satan is gonna do everything he can to destroy you, to make you lose faith. He's gonna poke you in the spots that hurts the most. But it even says here, it says resist him. Stand firm. And you know what? You guys aren't the only one that goes through it. God gives you reassurance. Saying your brothers are going through it. Your sisters are going through it. You're not alone. I felt alone this week. But realizing it, I have such great brothers and sisters surrounding me. The ones that support me. The ones that rebuke me, and the ones that pray for me each and every day, telling me what I do wrong, telling me what I'm doing right. But I felt alone because I chose that I couldn't trust them. That's an emotion you put on yourself. But once you put that emotion on yourself, Satan's going to do everything. He's like, oh, I got him. I got you. He's going to do everything to make you feel alone. But my brothers and sisters, you're not alone. I don't share my problems to tell you, hey, I have it worse. I don't tell you my problems to say, life sucks for me. No, life is great. I have everything that I possibly need. I have God. You have God. I tell you my problems to tell you, you're not alone. Each and every day, you wake up, you're not alone. First of all, you have God. So obviously, therefore, you can't be alone. Like I said in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8, you know, God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He hasn't left you. He's still there. Loving you just the same way he always has. And I want to just continue to encourage you guys to continue to fight. And with this one last verse, I'll just go ahead and close this. 1 John chapter 3, verse 1.
just really shows that the world doesn't understand. It says, how great is the love of the Father, how great is the love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. Believe it, everyone. We truly are a child of God. And hey, if you're struggling, great. That means Satan knows that you're a child of God. He can do everything he can to fight. He's going to do everything he can do to fight. So you do everything you can do to fight while having God on your side. Because you can persevere with God. And you will persevere with God. If you believe it. Let's go ahead. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you once again for my brothers and sisters. I thank you for just allowing me to share this great news to my brothers, knowing that you are here with us today. Lord, you know, I'm not going to lie, you know, none of us are perfect. But Lord, I know through you, we can persevere through you. We have hope and strength and encouragement. Father, I pray for my brothers and sisters as we get on through the rest of our weeks, that you continue to be with us, Lord. And I know you're always with us, but continue to allow us to understand your love, Lord. Continue to allow us to understand what it means to continue to fight without giving up, Lord. I pray, Lord, that we may be able to share with each other, open up to each other, and grow with each other as a congregation for you, Father. And Father, Lord, I truly pray that you really work within Crossover, within us, within Pastor David, and with all the leaders over here and all our people, Lord, that you will continue to work with them. Father, I thank you for the grace that you have poured upon us today and the grace you always do pour upon us. And Father, I pray as Pastor David comes up here that you really just stir in his heart as well and just speak through him. I thank you, Heavenly Father, for being so great and mighty, being my rock, my redeemer, and my life. All this morning for me, I pray.
Thank you for those words. I just feel like I'm off. Oh man, this is on? Hello? 1, 2. Can you hear me now? Yeah, it's this life. It's a marathon. You know, it's a journey. It's every day getting up, doing grinding, praying. You know, when you run this race, and as Andrew pointed out, it's that you don't run this race by yourself. You have a team behind you. You have people rooting for you. And Hebrews tells us that there's people in heaven, in the cloud of witnesses, rooting for you and cheering on for you and to motivate you and to really see you do these things for the things of the Lord. You know, and it's tough. It's tough because, you know, believe it or not, I may share this with you, but believe it or not, many years ago, I used to run cross country. Yes, thank you. Some of you are laughing. I don't know why. It's true. And I ran, and I think I shared with you that it was the toughest thing that I ever encountered in life. And the only reason why I did is because I love playing basketball. And the reason why I love playing basketball, the reason why I ran cross country is the basketball coach said that we all had to run cross country because he was also the cross country coach. Right? So if you wanted to play basketball, you had to run cross country. So I joined cross country, and it was agonizing. It was tough. The heat, running for 3 miles, is not my thing to do in this life. But I did it. Why? Because I love basketball. In the very same way, you love God, you stick in this marathon. You push, you fight, you be ready, continue, pursue. You do not give up. Do not give up. And as Andrew pointed out, the lion, the Satan's out there, he's going to do everything he can to, when you feel like you're growing, to come and attack, and you're like, why did I even bother? Why did I even do this? Why did I even want to be, a servant or someone involved in church? Because he wants nothing more for you to live this life, your journey away from God. Yet you may be a Christian, But his job is for you to lose that relationship with Christ so that you will not have joy or peace or comfort, and that you will always be in this life wondering, questioning, hurting. And that's not what Christ, that's not what God intended for us to live on this earth. Sort of like, what, you know, it's kind of tied in today's message. I know lately, you know, as my kids are getting older, they're becoming teens, I am getting familiarized with a lot of those terminology and things of their nature. You know, things that I don't really see or understand, you know, like especially now these days about texting. And I text, but I text long way. You know, I spell out the words as much as I can. You know, and then I was reading this, like the top 10 acronyms for texting. It's like number one was G2G or something. And I was, you know, what does that mean?
Gotta go.
You see, but lots of times, my wife and I were one time reading it, and it said SMH. And we're like, oh, he said that word. And I found out I was shaking my head. I said, okay. You know, I don't know these terminology, you know, LOL or RIOL or all these different things. But today's message is, I entitled it, YOLO. Right? YOLO. The reason why is for the longest time I thought YOLO was a frozen yogurt. I kid you not, I thought YOLO was a frozen yogurt. I thought they were saying YOLO, they're talking about a brand of a yogurt. And then finally somebody told me, man, you only live once. You only live once. Right, so throughout this message, I'm not just saying YOLO. All right, but when you, I want you to think about that YOLO, YOLO, right, YOLO, and then some of you are like, oh my God, you know, because people put it up there too often, YOLO this, YOLO that, and I had to kind of understand, like, what does it really mean, YOLO? You know, it's another way of saying that life is brief, life is now, and you should seize the moment. In some ways, all those things that they're saying about YOLO is somewhat categorizes a lot of us, isn't it? We are taught, don't put off anything until tomorrow. You know, assuming that you can catch up is false. We got to live the moment. Seize the moment. Do the things right now, right? YOLO, YOLO. That's why I'm going to go bungee jumping, YOLO. I'm never going to do that, man. No way. I want to continue to live on that, you know? But you only live once. You only live once. Think that for a moment. You're only going to go through this life once. You're only going to walk this journey once. You're only going to do the things of Christ once in this lifetime. As a child of God, as a believer, that motto, you only live once, to resonate in us, to live every single moment, every single day for the things of God, for Christ's glory. YOLO. It's for my God and His purpose and His love and His will. Last week, that's what we talked about, didn't it? We talked about, you know, what was God's will? And we kind of talked about God's will for us was salvation, that He wanted salvation for all men. We talked about God's will was to be a peacemaker, to induce peace instead of stirring up things, instead of causing commotions or causing things to get arguments. Be a peacemaker. We talked about sexual purity, that God's will was for us to be sexual pure, to stay away, abstain from premarital sex, to stay away from pornography, to stay away from the things that would lust come into your heart, to be sexual pure. He talked about last week that God's will was to submit to authority. That whoever God places in your life of authority, you are to honor, and that you are to obey, and that you are to submit under that authority. We talked about last week that God's will was rejoice, pray, and be thankful. Always. Always. But today I want to talk to you about how to respond to the will of God. How are we to respond to the will of God? You see, when you look at throughout the scriptures, it gives us so many marks of a Christian or a true Christian. You know, the scriptures tell us what a true mark of a Christian is. Someone that loves God, someone that is repentant from their sin, someone that's humility, someone that prays, someone that loves others, someone that is separated from the world, someone that obeys. But I'm telling you right now, nothing characterizes a true believer than his desire to do the will of God. If you are a true believer, your desire is to do the will of God. That characterizes if you are a true believer or not. Do you have the desire? The word desire is like this passion. This overwhelming thing that's in your heart that says, nothing in this world is going to separate me from my Lord. You have a desire for your relationships. Valentine's is coming up in a couple weeks. Those of you who are dating or married, those who are looking, your desire is for that other person, and that your desire is to do whatever that person wants. And that desire is that for the other person. How much more desire should you have to your God, to your Savior, to your Lord? This is what David said in Psalm 48. I desire to do your will, my God. Your law is within my heart. In Psalm 143:10, David also says, teach me to do your will, for you are my God. It was David's passion. It was David's desire to do anything but the desires of God. Even Jesus taught in Mark chapter 3, verse 35, whoever does God's will is my brother, my sister, and my mother. We are to do His will, not ours. If we are continuing to do our will, if we continue to live this life in this earth, continue to say, I will, I want, this is mine, this is who I want, you're nothing but what Satan is. Do you know that Satan, that's the very reason why he got kicked out of heaven? If you look at Isaiah chapter 14, verse 13 through 14, it says that Satan said this, I will ascend to the heavens, I will raise my throne, I will sit enthroned in front of all the mount of assemblies in the most highest. I will ascend above the tops of the cloud. This is what Satan said. I will, I will, I will. How many of you are here saying, I will, I want, it's me? You only live once. What are you going to do? What impact are you going to make? What lifestyle are you going to live? What legacy will you leave behind? Because you're only going to go through this world once. In James chapter 4, verse 13 through 15. You see, James was struggling with the same very thing with people in his church. Believers who are not totally dedicated to their God. And if you look at today's verse in James chapter 4, verse 13 through 15, if you have your Bibles, turn there. James chapter 4, verse 13 through 15, and this is the Word of God. It says, now, come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we'll go to such and such a city, spend a year there, buy and sell and make profit. Whereas you do not know what will happen tomorrow. But what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that. Lord Father, I pray that you'll be with this message, Lord. I pray you empower the Spirit of you, Lord, to speak your truth. And I pray, Lord, that we will just listen to the words and be challenged, and that we may, in our lives, Lord Father, give us your teachings and your wisdom. We lift up all of us into your name, I pray. Amen. James begins this verse with, come now. Come now. That is a statement. That is an urgent cry. It's meaning to, he was talking to his people, his congregation. He's saying, listen up. Listen up. I got something to tell you. Pay attention. This is important. Come now. And he says that you who are, what he says right there, he says, come now, you who say. That you who say is basically what's referred to, as we learned, is that these are the people that were generally in a habitual way of living their lives, the very same thing always. Meaning that they were always consistently living their lives without God, and they're as Christians. And that's what he's saying, you who are. He's categorizing them. He's separating from other people. He said, you who are, those are saying this. And he says that what? He says, today or tomorrow we'll go into such and such a place and spend a year there and trade and make profits. What he's saying, what James is saying, is that those that were living those days, and even to those people that are living here, the believers, the Christians, the children of God, are doing things in their lives without God. Without His wisdom. Without confronting and asking, wondering what God would say. It means that doing business, getting married, making life decisions, doing all these things that you are normally to do in your life without asking God. God is not even in the picture. You see, James breaks it down. He's referring to a businessman. And there's a lot of businessmen back in the days, and they were very successful. And he breaks it down. He says, number one, he says, all you who are saying this today or tomorrow, he's saying to them, look, you already made your plans. You already chose the time that you're going to do it. Did you even ask God about His time? Did you even ask God about what He thought about what time or what day or how you should be able to conduct this business or conduct your ministry or conduct your family or conduct how you should go about the day? Do you even come close to even praying before God in the morning before you even start the day and say, Lord, this is what I want to do. What do you say, Lord? It says there today or tomorrow, these people have already started to make their own time. The second thing that they do is they start to choose their own location. It says there, and right here it says, we will go into such and such a town. So James is saying, you already chose a place too. Not just the time, but you already made a time. You already said, oh, I'm going to go there. I'm going to do this. Yes, the place that I'm going to go, I know that's for me. They chose their own period of how long they're going to go to that certain place. Oh, I know that when I go there, I'm going to stay there for 4 years. Yeah. You know, when I go this place, get two years, 3 years, that's fine. Yeah, I know. They already settled their purpose or what they're going to do when they get there. It says right here, it says, you'll spend a year there and trading, doing business, buy and sell. And the fifth thing, they already chose their own goal. What was their plan? It was to go and make profit. See, James was breaking these five things that most people deal with in their lives. These are the five things that most people, we question and we wonder and we always think about, what am I going to do with my life? Where am I going to go? What am I going to do? And then we sit here and we pray. Sometimes we don't even pray. We sit here and we discuss and we try to find all these different things. And we go through all these things, like the internet search, or do all these different, oh, this looks like a good place. And then we put all, we set out to do these things. Now, James is not saying that all these things are bad. James is not saying that you shouldn't have goals. James is not saying that you should not do all these different things. What James is saying is, if you have all these, you need to put it before the Lord. You need to set all these things before God and say, God, what do you think? God, what do you say? God, what do you think about your time? God, what do you think about this place? God, what do you think about when I get there? You know, what would you have me to do? These people, these Christians, these businessmen, their lives had no regard for God's will. Not just their lives, but their future had no regards of God's will. Simply stated, many people live their lives as if God does not exist. Do you live your life as though God exists? Or do you live your life as though He doesn't? There's a very well-known atheist. Her name is Madeline Murray O'Hare. Maybe some of you know her. She was responsible for prayer being removed from the public schools in this country. She is a very devout atheist. Some will call her an intellectual atheist. And she was noted for saying this: I do not believe God exists. I do not believe that God exists. As much as I want to say you're wrong, I have to kind of honor her because of what she believes. Because I'm telling you right now, there's another terminology that is out there, and that is called a practical atheist. A practical atheist. And a practical atheist says that they know there is a God, but they don't live like that. They know that there is God, but their lives have no clue of God's existence in their lives. I know that maybe many of you here believe in God. Well, many of you say that you've given your life to Christ. But are you a practical atheist? Are you someone that says, I believe in God, but never seeks His guidance, seeks His wisdom, seek His word? As a child of God, your consideration ought to be, what would God have me to do with my life? What is the Lord's will in this situation? You see, nothing that we do, nothing that we plan, nothing will ever pass without God's hands in it. No matter how much you try to do something, I'm telling you right now, it may never come to pass. But I'm telling you right now, whatever He wants will always be done. You need to seek the Lord first in every matter. In every situation, you must seek Him. Matthew tells us, seek ye His kingdom first, that all these things shall be added unto you. Seek Him first. Our goals, our plans, everything about us must be given to God. Why? YOLO. You only live once. If you're going to live once in this world, you might as well rest in the one that can get things done. Amen? Listen. James tells us that if we ignore God's will, if we ignore Him, there are two things that will happen. Look at verse 14. It says, yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanish. You know what James is saying is that if you ignore God's will, if you continue to do what you want to do, your life is not guaranteed. You're not guaranteed to live tomorrow. You're not guaranteed to live right past you, past this door. That James is teaching us that life is uncertain. Life is uncertain. These business people right here, they were conducting their plan, their strategy without God, like that's going to happen, that they know that was going to happen, that they're for sure that was going to happen. How do they know that after that meeting, one of those guys that went down the road and got hit by a camel? We don't know.
That's pretty funny.
That just popped in my head. Listen, life is filled with too many variables. They're filled with too many circumstances. They're filled with too many things that go on in this life. How do they know their future was secure? How do we know our future is secure? Nobody knows what life will throw. Isn't that what Nationwide says? Life comes at you, what, fast? Nationwide is obvious. That's baloney, man. Right? We don't know what life is going to come. It happens in a blink of an eye. You ask all those people that were at the mall in Maryland, in Columbia the other day. You go there and you ask them, oh, you think there's going to be a shooting? Nobody knows. You could have been one of those three that was sitting there and you're just minding your own business and boom, gun spray and then you got hit. You could be driving in a car and then get hit. You don't know. You just don't know. James tells us that your life is like a mist. It's like a mist that when you see it, it vanishes quickly. Proverbs 27:1 says, do not boast about tomorrow, for you do not know what day may bring tomorrow. That is why we must all put our trust, all about who we are, everything into God's will, into His hands. Because in Matthew chapter 6, verse 31-33, it says, so do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For this is the pagans that, this is what they do. Isn't God the one that provides everything for you? Isn't He the one that he does everything for you? No matter how well out your plans are, no matter how well that you think your future is, no matter how well that you think you're putting all this money into this saving account, we just don't know. What we do know is that if we put ourselves in the Lord's will, things will live. You see, that little verse in verse 15, it says, if the Lord wills. This is just not some catchphrase. It should be the very way of life for us. As believers, that is our life, is doing what God wills. See, James just doesn't talk about the uncertainties of life. But he tells us that life is short. Life is short. You know, the Bible says a lot of things about death. 1 Chronicles 29:15 says, we are foreigners and strangers in this life, as were all our ancestors. Our days on earth are like shadow, without hope. Job 7:6 says, my days are swifter than a weaver's shuttle, and are spent without hope. Job 8:9 says, for we are but of yesterday, and know nothing, because our days upon our earth are as shadows. Job 9:25-26 says, now my days are swifter than a post. They flee away, they see no good, they are passed away as swift as ships, as eagle that has to the prey. In Psalms 39:4-5 says, Lord, make me know to my end, and the measure of my days, what it is, that I may know how frail I am. Behold, thou hast made my days as a handbreadth, and my age I was nothing before there. Verily, every man at his best state is altogether vanity. And in Psalms 103:15-16 says, as for man, his days are like grass, as a flower of the field, so he flourished. For the wind passes over, and everything is gone. You see, the Bible talks a lot about death. And Jesus also talks about the rich farmer, our parable, in Luke chapter 12, verse 13-21. And it said, someone in the crowd said to him, teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me. Jesus replied, man, who appointed me a judge or an arbiter between you? Then he said to them, watch out, be on guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in abundance of possessions. And Jesus told this parable. He says, the ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, what shall I do? I have no place to store all my crops. Then he said, this is what I'll do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And there I will store my surplus grain. And I say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool. This very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves, but not rich toward God. Do you understand what this parable is saying? God is saying to this man that was rich, he's saying, I have all this money, I'm going to store it up, I'm going to build more better things, I'm going to do all these things, but God is not in the picture. And God says, from this day, you fool, this very day, I am taking you away from this place. And then what's going to happen to your stuff? This rich farmer's mistake was that he was planning everything without God. So I'm telling you right now, YOLO, you only live once. What is your plan? What are you planning? Are you planning a wedding? Are you planning to go out with someone? Are you planning a business? Are you planning to go to school? You're planning to take something with your family? Whatever it could be, whatever situation, everything must be submitted to God. Why is it must be submitted to God? Because look at verse 15. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this and do that. James gives a blessing to those who put God and His will, the central part of their plans. You know what that blessing is? That blessing is knowing that your God, my God, is sovereign of all aspects of life. And because of that one thing, you can live. You can live. I'm telling you, look, doing God's will. And what are those wills? We talked about it last week. They're not all the wills of God, but they're like the major ones. Going out, reaching the lost souls, reaching your brothers and sisters, reaching out your family, reaching out your coworkers, reaching out your students, whoever it might be, reaching out for those with salvation. It's about making sure that you're a peacemaker, that you're in peace with everyone. It's about, you know, staying sexually pure. It means to rejoice, be thankful, and to pray in all circumstances. And I know I'm missing one. But why do we do this? Why do we do the will of God? As a Christian, it's an act of worship. And it's done from the heart. And it's got to be the way of life. You see, Jesus says in John chapter 13, verse 17, now that you know these things, God's will, you will be blessed if you do them. It's not my words. This is Jesus' words himself. If you do God's will, you will be blessed if you do that. That doesn't mean that you follow this and that you do all the wills of God and you're expecting to be rich or be happy or whatever. That's not what being blessed means. Being blessed means that no matter what situation that you're in, no matter how hard it is, no matter how much you want to give up, no matter how much you want to throw in the towel, being blessed by God is that you know that He loves you so much. And that you know that no matter how bad the situation is, that your God, your Christ will never leave you. And that you know that His arms are around you. And He's holding you. And He's urging you. And He's pushing you. And He's motivating you. Say, keep on. Keep doing it. Yes, you're going to have a tough time. And yes, the reality is, you know, if I'm up here saying that we're going to have a prosperity, we're going to be rich, we're going to have blessings, we're going to be happy all the time, I'm a liar. just this very week, I had a tough week too. And Andrew came up to me and said, how was your week? I said, good. And Andrew said, oh, your week is always good. Why is he saying that? I'm not trying to put anything on me, but I get it. I know that life is hard. I know that I'm going to run into some situations. But no matter what comes in my way, I'm still happy because I have Christ. I have salvation. I have my God, my Savior, my Redeemer, my Lover. Do God's will. Do what pleases your God. YOLO. Next time you see YOLO, hopefully you'll get to understand you only live once for God. You only live once for God. Let's pray.